Thank you all so much for being here today. And I'd like to open my talk with an anecdote. So, one weekend morning when I was sitting in a coffee shop, with my back against a wall, a man in a tracksuit began to make his way towards me. And so, instinctively, I began to look around for things that I could use to defend myself with. And just as I was tightening my grip on the coffee cup, he swung into the seat opposite me and said, "Hello." I remained silent. But the next question he asked caught me off guard. "Are you familiar with artificial intelligence?" Still, I didn't say anything, and he took this as an invitation to continue speaking. "Well, you see that on television, artificial intelligence is always portrayed as an evil thing, and robots are always bringing about the end of the world. I want to make a television show about artificial intelligence that can help people." And he then proceeded to outline a 12-episode series about a robot helper and its relationship with his human client. He then asked me to help him write his screenplay, at which point I politely declined and left the coffee shop. Yet, as strange as unexpected that encounter was, it got me thinking about artificial intelligence, its potential applications, its perils, and moreover, its capacity for language. So, two questions. In terms of the applications of artificial intelligence in imitating human language, where were we at? Where are we are now? And where are we going? Is there a limit to the language learning capacities of artificial intelligence systems? Today, I will be unpacking these two questions. So, where were we at? In his 1950 article, Computing and Theory of Intelligence, Alan Turing, computer scientist, postulated that if a robot can engage in an entirely text-based conversation with a human being and convince that human being that the robot is another human being at least 30% of the time, then the robot can be said to have the capacity for human language and hence thought. While Turing's initial aim was to propose a creative way of understanding the interaction between humans and machines, the tests that he formulated has served as the standards for artificial intelligence programs since its conception. However, to this day, the Turing test has remained largely unchallenged. And why? The reason for that is that human languages are incredibly ambiguous. From a linguistics viewpoint, even moderate sentences of 30 words in length can have countless possible syntactic structures. And so a computerized natural language processor would have to be able to search through all the possible alternatives and then decide which one makes sense in the context. Let's take a look at the sentence, "Kelly drove up the hill in her car." Whereas you and I might be able to instantly tell that this sentence refers to the fact that Kelly is driving up the hill while riding in her car, it's not so easy for computers. There are two possible interpretations of the sentence. It looked better before. Basically, the first interpretation is what we might assume, that Kelly is inside her car and that she's driving up the hill. However, there's a second interpretation, that Kelly is driving up the hill being located inside her car. While technically correct, this interpretation is nonsensical in a real-world context. The ambiguity arises because the preposition can either modify road or hill, and this is an instance of what we can call prepositional phrase attachment ambiguity. And so, given this incredible ambiguity of the words and the possible interpretations, for computers, interpreting even the most simple sentences can result in a combinatorial landslide of possibilities. And so, various research efforts from the 1950s have been directed in coordinating the language interpretation abilities of artificial intelligence systems. For instance, in the 1960s, Margaret Masterman and her team at MIT My apologies to the University of Cambridge, designed semantic nets for machine translation to aid a better and more seamless process of computers being able to interpret the words that they receive. And then later, by 1965, Joseph Weizenbaum and his team at MIT built ELIZA, which is an interactive program that's capable of carrying on a dialogue in English on most study topics. It was particularly popular when it featured as a toy on ARPANET, the then version of the internet, because it was able to simulate the dialogue between a psychotherapist and the user, who would be the patient. Later in the 1970s, you can see that Barbara Gross established limits to traditional artificial intelligence approaches to discourse math modeling, thereby making the sort of understanding of a conversation between a computer and the user more codified. Subsequent work developed the notion of centering, which could establish